I was wondering as I was watching the video with the song behind it, People Need the Lord, and I wondered what our thoughts were. And I'm going to step on some toes. If you felt pity for people that you saw, that's not what God wants you to feel. But if you felt love, respect, value in the people that you saw, that would be what God would want you to feel. If you were able to look at people who even were doing things that are very different than what you do in religion, but could see that they're still people that God loves and cares about, that's what God would want you to think about. People need the Lord. But there are some, well, let's face it, there are some negative ways that we can show the love of God to the world, aren't there? We can actually be kind of rude in our expression of God's love. I don't remember if it's still in my notes or not, but I'm going to come to it later, but I just want to think about this. How many atheists knock on your door and tell you they want to share their worldview with you? None? No atheists come and tell you, I want to share my worldview. I want to change your life. I want to help you find a better way. I think it's Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses, and sometimes Christians. Right? Come knocking on the door. Or hold up a tract, give you a tract, or hold up a sign. You know, by the way, I'm just going to say this. If you're going out on Sunday after worship, and you go out to a restaurant, how many of you ever go out to eat after worship? Please don't leave a tract. Leave a double top tip. All right? You know, sometimes we, on Sunday, right after worship, we're sometimes the worst people at the restaurants. We're impatient because the food takes too long because of all the other church people that are there. Okay? And you want it faster, and it didn't come the way you wanted it, and you just get kind of downright rude to the people that are out there serving you. And they go away saying, what do they go away saying about church people? Top that off, if when you were out there, your conversation was, I can't believe the video he showed in church today. And then I can't believe what he said after he showed the video. And did you see that what those people were doing in front of us? And I can't believe she dresses that way. And you go on, whatever. You go on and on talking about other people. What does that communicate to the people around you in the restaurant? Because you do realize they hear you, don't you? Or do you intend for them to hear you? Maybe some of us are going out to restaurants and we want to talk bad about God, the church, the neighbor, whomever, because we want other people to know we think bad of people, right? Well, today we are talking about the fourth piece of putting legs to faith. The first piece was loving God. And one of the things that we said in loving God, Jesus puts the commandment right along with it. He says, look, this is equal to loving God. You got to love your neighbor as yourself. They go hand in hand. In fact, you cannot say, I love God, but I hate that guy over there, especially where he parked his car again, okay? And the mess he made out there, okay, I hate him, but oh, I love God. Jesus said you can't do the two things. You got to love God, you got to love your neighbor as you love yourself. Encouraging one another. Encouraging is that word that comes from the word for paraclete, the Holy Spirit, the one who comes alongside, the comforter, the encourager. We are called to come alongside of one another. That takes feeling somebody else's pain, listening to what they're going through in their life, caring about who they are, and really meaning that. The third leg is to grow as Christ's disciples. We've been given a commission, a responsibility to go out into the world and live there like Jesus and to keep becoming more and more like Jesus. And here in the church, when we gather together as a body, when we gather together, we're supposed to be equipping one another to help us grow to become more like Jesus Christ. That's why we're here, right? In fact, the fact is, you know, you really only spend a little bit of time worshiping, don't you? If you think about it, how much time does the church really have to equip you for ministry? Maybe 5 hours a week, if that. So it's, you know, there's really not a lot that is done, really. We got life groups, we got the Sunday morning worship and all, times of talking and praying. But the bottom line is, we're out there in the world a lot more than we are ever gathered together. The fourth leg today is sharing Jesus. You know, some of us might think about that as, that's evangelism, that's witnessing. Ah! You don't get all scared about that, right? You know, I can't tell people about Jesus. You know, I can't, oh no, that's going to be really too hard. I'm not going to know what to say. How can I convince them? And they're going to throw me out. You know, well, they might. But the fact is that, let me tell you this. You are sharing Jesus, the Jesus that you know, every single day, wherever you're at, whatever you're doing. You are. If Jesus lives inside of you, if you've accepted what Jesus did for you on the cross, you've believed that he's God and Savior, you've said yes to him coming into your life, you've been baptized, you've made that public commitment that says, look, I've committed my life to Jesus Christ. If you've done those things, guess what? Where's Jesus? Isn't he? So wherever you're at, whatever you're doing, are people seeing Jesus in you? Well, they are. I guess maybe the more important question is, are they seeing the real Jesus? Or is the Jesus they're seeing in you is a grumpy, grouchy, you know, fussy, negative, mean-spirited old duffer? I mean, what? What is the world seeing when they look at you? Oh, God has called us to share Jesus. Last night, and some of you probably heard about this even before I did, but I got a call asking if I would go to Lake Arrowhead. And Chief Hartwick, who is the fire chief for San Bernardino County Fire Department, his son, 20 years old, came up to a mountain, Lake Arrowhead, with some of his friends. They rented a cabin over on Burnt Mill, over by the Lake Arrowhead village. About 2:00 in the afternoon, his son went out for a walk, and unfortunately, he was not dressed for cold weather. He did have snow boots on, but he was like in a t-shirt. And he headed out at 2:00. At 5:00, he was seen down at Lake Arrowhead Village. 10:44 in the evening, they reported him, his friends reported him missing. He had not come back. At about 1 a.m. this morning, his body was found in the lake. 20 years old, came up here to have fun with his friends. There were... Wow, I would say there must have been 200 to 300 people actually out when you look at all the firefighters, the sheriffs, the volunteers, CERT team members that were searching for Dawson throughout Saturday once they could marshal all the troops. And the sad thing is that there were some reports that he was seen, like I say, in the parking lot, ended up, somebody even saw him jumping into the lake. I still kind of wonder, why didn't anyone call the sheriff? And I share that with you because, do you realize how much Chief Hartwick right now needs somebody just to love him? Fortunately, Mark and his wife, his family know Jesus. But do you just imagine how broken they are right now? So last night, what's my responsibility as a chaplain? I mean, because most people know when I arrive, I'm a chaplain. What's my responsibility? You know, when I get there, all I can do is just walk around and care about people. One of the other battalion chiefs on the mountain, Larry Laveau, had a daughter killed in an automobile crash about 2 years ago now, a year and a half, something like that. One of the first people I saw was Larry when I got to Lake Arrowhead last night. And my first question to Larry was, how are you doing? Here he's got this responsibility to try to, I mean, he was one of the main people, the first attack people trying to locate Dawson, trying to find where he was. But think about that. Here's Larry looking for his chief's son, and he's still in his own grief at the loss of his daughter. The pain. I guess why I share this story with you, and I'm sorry I'm sharing it right at the beginning, and some of you will be really stressed out by it, or it'll be too deep for you. But the fact is that wherever we're at, we are around people who need us to live God's love right there in front of them. Just live it. And let them see God's love through us. So the title that I've set for today's message is Be a World Changer in Your World. Be a World Changer in Your World. God has called us to be world changers. Now, when you think about that, isn't that what the Great Commission was all about? Go into all the world, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, teaching them to obey all I've commanded you. Lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. That's the Great Commission, right? And we hear that and we say, whoa, we got to get the whole world. We've got over 2.5 billion Christians right now. We've got about 6 billion non-Christians out there. That's a big task, but that, well, okay, 2.5, 6. Okay, so we only have, each of us have to reach 6 other people, right? Then it's done. Well, it's a little more complicated than that. But the fact is that God has called us to an incredible mission. But we are not, it's his body that reaches the whole world, but we individually don't reach the whole world, do we? Individually, we are called to be world changers in our world, right where we live. The text that I've selected for this morning is Mark, the 5th chapter. I probably need to set the stage a little bit. Jesus has had some amazing experiences already. Last night, if I were picking it up at the story, last night he calmed the storm as the boat was going across the lake. The storm got really bad. Disciples, what are you sleeping for, Jesus? And so he says, storm, be quiet. Now, what do you guys want? You're bothering my sleep. You guys just don't have faith, do you? Do you not realize, if I'm in this boat and I'm God, the boat's not going down and you're all safe as long as you're with me. Well, they get onto the shore and they come up to this man called the man from Gerasene. He's a man that's got 1,000 demons in him by his own description. When talked to by Jesus, he's asked, what's wrong with you? And he says, well, and what's your name? And he says, my name is Legion, meaning I've got 1,000 demons in here with me. This guy's going through a graveyard. He cuts himself with stones. He breaks chains when they try to chain him up. He runs around naked. I mean, he's literally, he sounds like a pretty crazy guy. Whew. Doing some pretty crazy things. And Jesus comes up and stops him. Talks to the demons in him, casts the demons out into a bunch of pigs, literally. The pigs jump off into the water and get drowned. The people who take care of the pigs are like, oh no. Go down to town and say, tell the story of what happened. The people come out and they say, would you please leave? You're dangerous. We don't want you around here. The man comes, and that's where we pick up the story. Mark, the 5th chapter, and we're going to read at verse 15. When they came to Jesus, they saw the man who had been possessed by the legion of demons sitting there, dressed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people what had happened to the demon-possessed man and told him about the pigs as well. Then the people began to plead with Jesus to leave their region. As Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him. Jesus did not let him, but said, "Go home to your family and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." So the man went away and began to tell in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and all the people were amazed. So the fourth leg for putting legs to your faith is sharing Jesus. Whoop, I don't want you, sir. my iPad, you know, some of you who have that sorry lady or whatever, you can talk to on here. She'll answer your questions as she just decided to come alive. Why did Jesus come to earth? What was his purpose? Luke 19:10 says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost." That's his purpose. He's going to head to Jerusalem, eventually to a cross, for that one sole purpose, to seek and to save what was lost. And he means lost to him and God the Father and the Holy Spirit. People who are lost from them. Christ died to save lost people. And as Christians, we are given a group of people that we're supposed to care for, love. It's called oikonomia. We have an oikos. The word oikos talks, it stands for our household. People that we come in regular contact with. We'll be talking about the 8 to 15 people that we have regular contact with on sometimes even a daily basis. Who do you live with? That's your oikos. Who do you spend a lot of time with? That's your oikos. Who are the people that you're talking to maybe almost every day? It could be a supplier that supplies something for your business. It could be somebody you're trying to get a job from. It could be somebody that's a neighbor. It could be a family member. But who are the people that are part of your life on a regular basis? God's called us to reach them. In fact, 2 Corinthians says, 5:16, we have been given the ministry, the message, the responsibility of sharing reconciliation, the message of reconciliation. God has called us to share that. That is the job of oikonomia. Now, interesting. I guess what I want to point out, help us try to do today is I want us to try to identify our oikos. I need to back up just slightly. Take note. Okay, first, when they came to Jesus, they saw the man who had been possessed by the legion of demons sitting there dressed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Who's this? These are people that know this man. What's scaring them? Shouldn't they be kind of like happy right now? Whoa, look at that guy. I mean, that's the dude that was like really a mess running around naked and everything. He's sitting there clothed and he's in his right mind. And what does it say? They were terrified. They were afraid of the power that Jesus had exerted over this man. And unfortunately, they were afraid of the power he had over the pigs, which meant the demons. Those who had seen it told the people what had happened to the demon-possessed man and told him about the pigs as well. Here's the thing. Did the community know this guy? Quite well. And now the community knows something has changed, and the people that have seen what have changed, the closest people to this man, they're telling the other people about it. Are you in a community or are you a hermit? It looks to me like none of you are hermits. You're here today, you wouldn't be a hermit, okay? So you're somehow in a community. Guess what? People are watching you. People see you all the time. They see your behavior. They can hear you at your house. They know how you drive. And they may even talk about it. People around you see you. And they watch you. And they can tell, okay, is he running through the slow down, Bill. Is he running through the cemetery naked? They can tell that, right? People that are around you. They can tell how crazy you are. Because people are watching you. So the people are watching. They see this guy has changed. And then the people began to plead with Jesus. Jesus, would you kind of like go away? Now, I think there's a couple reasons for that. Number one, I think they were saying that because some of them had owned those pigs and the economy of their community was about to change because the pigs had gone off the mountain. And it was over 1,000 of them, all destroyed. Like, okay, this is really scary because this guy has this kind of power. Let's just get him on out of our community. They also are in a place, and then notice this man's going to go to the Decapolis. The Decapolis is a place, you can talk to Leslie about this, a place that has all kinds of gods being worshipped. People are actually thrown down into the caverns, and if the blood comes through the water, it means, oh, the gods accepted the sacrifice. And if not, you're just dead. Well, actually, you're dead either way, but they're worshipping all kinds of gods there. And then actually, people are afraid of the gods. And Jesus is being kind of godlike here, and it scares them. So please just leave. But then the thing that really happens that is significant comes in verse 19. Jesus did not let him. The man comes, verse 18, says, Jesus, I want to go with you. I want to follow you. I want to be one of your disciples too. I mean, look what you've done for me and the change you've made in my life. Jesus, I'm with you. Let's go. Please let me on the boat too. And what does Jesus say to him? No. No, you have an important, more important responsibility. Go back to your oikos. And that's the word that's actually used here in verse 19. Go back to your family. Go back to the people that you live with, the people that see you, the people that know you, the people in your community, the neighbors that know what you were like before this happened, before I came into your life. You go back to them and listen. Go home to your family, your oikos, and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has mercy on you. And what's the man do? He heads to the Decapolis. He's got to go talk to his community. He's got to talk to his oikos, all these people that have known all about him. He's got to tell them what Jesus Christ has done for him, and the people are amazed because of it. Go home to your people. Tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you. Here's the thing. We do not get to select our oikos. If you're gonna identify your oikos, you got to realize you don't get to select who's in your oikos. How many of you picked who was going to be your neighbor? Well, I sure hope you took it into some consideration before you moved there, right? You know, but then they moved away. The very ones you wanted to move by, they moved away because they didn't like their new neighbor. No. Tom Mercer, a friend of mine who pastors a really large mega church up in the high desert called High Desert Church, has written a book called Common Sense is the New Brilliance. He said, the important thing for us to remember is that each of us has a limited audience with whom we can have meaningful interaction. Our challenge is to discover who makes up that audience and leverage those connections to both display and defend our faith in Jesus. He goes on to say, a local church is a support group for people who all want to change their world. We're a support group. That's why we're here. To encourage, to love on one another, to grow as Christ's disciples, and together, because of our support for one another, we're going out there to change the world. I found an article by Tom Rainier that says 15 reasons our churches are less evangelistic today. Would you say that we are less or more evangelistic than the church was 20 years ago? Most people would say less. And here's what he says. Christians have no sense of urgency to reach lost people. Many Christians and church members do not befriend and spend time with lost persons. Rob, one of my pastor friends in Big Bear, has a small group, and he's been asking that small group to pray for their oikos, to get to know people who don't know Christ. And the whole small group said, we don't know anybody who's not a Christian. Wow. Wow. I mean, that's really kind of amazing. That means everybody they come in contact with, the UPS guy that delivers the UPS packages to their house, the neighbor person, the people that they go to the market and buy their food from, the cashier, I mean, all these different people that they come in contact with, not a single one of them aren't church. They're all Christians. That's kind of amazing. I guess more of America is Christian than we thought. So number three, we are more known for what we are against than what we are for. I mean, that sure came out in the last political process, didn't it? Our churches have an ineffective evangelistic strategy of you come rather than we go. Isn't that our goal, is to get a whole bunch of people here? Well, if if they can grow here, and it might be a part of that process. Didn't Jesus say, while you're going, make disciples? So he really didn't say, y'all come. He says, let's all go. Really, really tempted. I'm resisting the temptation. I was really tempted to have you walk out around the neighborhood this morning. And the only reason why I'm not is afraid half of you won't come back. That was the other one, Leslie, but I didn't want to put that one out there. But it'd be really interesting to go out that door right now and just walk around the neighborhood all different directions. And just walk around. And see people if they're out. Or help somebody if they need help. Or just wave. Or just be in the community. God called us to go, not to come. Not to tell people to come. 6, many church members think that evangelism is the role of the pastor. And anyone else who's paid staff. Yes. Pastor, you're the hireling, right? You've got the really powerful gun. You go get them, okay? Especially if there's anyone tough. If you're a pastor, that you. Go for it, right? You know, I mean, isn't that why you paid me? You know, I'm supposed to do it. Why would you want to do it? You know, let me have all the fun. Give me the privilege to see life changed and people making new commitments to Jesus Christ. You wouldn't want to be a part of that, would you? Would you really want to be there when somebody walks from hell into heaven? Oh, no, you don't want to be a part of that. Would you want to be a part of somebody's life being changed in a moment because of Jesus Christ's love? No, leave that up to the pastor. He's paid to do it. So he ought to get all the blessings of that, shouldn't he? You're all missing out if you believe that. 7, church membership today is more about getting my needs met rather than reaching the lost. Ooh. So this is about me and what I can get. And that's why we shop to different churches and we look around for the different better experiences and all. Number 8, church members are in a retreat mode as culture becomes more worldly and unbiblical. Yeah, the world's just so bad that let's just kind of, let's go hide for a while because, we don't want to, it's too risky out there. They believe some really weird things out there. Look at all the people that were in that video. Do you know how to reach every single one of those different kind of people groups that you saw in the video? Oh my. Well, actually, you do. You do. And it's with one word. And it's with love. You already know. And it's not going to be about how much you know and talk them into something. It's going to be about how much you love. Number 9, many church members don't really believe that Christ is the only way of salvation. This may be one of the most dangerous ones on the list. We simply don't believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and life, and no one comes to the Father but through him. And maybe we have family members who don't believe in Jesus Christ, and because of that, we've worked up a new theology that says somehow in the last split second of eternity, Jesus is going to change their mind and then let them into heaven. Or, Jesus is so gracious, he's just going to let everybody in. But the fact is that Jesus is the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father but through him, and he offers that as an option, not a requirement. You are given the opportunity to go to heaven if you want it. You're not forced to go to heaven if you don't. But too much of the church today is saying, oh no, there's all kinds of ways to get there. Number 10, our churches are no longer houses of prayer equipped to reach the lost. What did Jesus say? When he comes in, he cleans out the temple and the money changers and all. He says, Father's house is to be a house of prayer. And too many of us don't pray together. In fact, husbands and wives, how many of you are praying with your spouse? We've lost the sense that this is meant to be a house of prayer, that the prayer sends us back out into the world to reach the lost. Number 11, churches have lost their focus on making disciples who will thus be equipped and motivated to reach the lost. The best way to make disciples is not to be a Billy Graham. I mean, it'd be wonderful if every one of you were a Billy Graham. The only problem with that is I think you'd be 93, is it now? But no, some of you know who Billy Graham is, right? younger people. Franklin Graham is his son. He did the prayer, one of the prayers at the invocation, at the inauguration of the president this last time. Billy Graham, evangelist who's reached thousands upon thousands of people. But guess what? You don't reach them by reaching the thousands. You reach people by reaching them one person at a time, one disciple to another. Number 12, Christians do not want to share the truth of the gospel for fear they will offend others. Yeah. Political correctness is too commonplace even among Christians. 13, most churches have unregenerate members who have not received Christ themselves. So we have many churches, and boy, mainline churches especially, lots of churches have lots of people sitting in the chairs and in the pews who don't really believe in Jesus Christ. The good news about that is, boy, we've already got people we can be winning right around us. 14, some churches have theological systems that do not encourage evangelism. You know, everyone's predestined, and those who are predestined will make it. Those who aren't won't. You know, too bad for them. So we don't need to do evangelism. And 15, our churches have too many activities. They are too busy to do the things that really matter. Oh, watch out. Watch out when you say, I'm too busy to tell somebody about Jesus because I've got to go prepare for the potluck. We've got the Super Bowl. I've got to make cookies. I've got to do this. I've got to be at worship. I just don't have time. And if the church work is in the way of what God's called us to do, we're not doing the right thing. I want to go on with something else that Tom said in a whole other article. And he said, what do non-Christians really think of us? You thought about that? What do non-Christians think of Christians? He actually takes these from postings that people have made on his blog. He says, on being selfish, not really interested in others. This is what non-Christians, you know, we're selfish and we're not really interested in others. He says, I remember a rather outspoken evangelical Christian young woman I worked with. This is a lady writing on the blog, her own story. I just moved to town and we went to a movie together. Each week she invited me to her church and I didn't want to offend her by saying no thanks. As it was, I had Buddhist activities one Sunday, and I was mentoring a young girl two other Sundays, but that theoretically left a Sunday open. We only worked together for 3 months, and it never worked out. I went to a different job. She showed up there one night and jumped right to the church invite. No, hey, how have you been? Haven't seen you in a while. None of that. No, just, do you want to come to church and go to church with me this weekend? Since I was on her game, I decided I would play. I said, sure, I'll go to church with you because I'm interested in seeing what you're interested in. That's what friends do, after all. And I'm sure you'll want to come with me to a Buddhist meeting to see what I'm interested in, right? Oh, no, she replied. I just love the Lord so much. Well, I said, then there's no point in me going to your church because I'm not interested in either becoming a Christian or joining your church. I never saw her again. That's how far Christian friendship extends. I've seen it over and over and over. Christians look at everyone else as if they've got targets painted on their foreheads. Nobody likes being hunted down or treating like someone else's project. We don't need to drop all our beliefs just to accept yours, and we don't need to become more like you just to be acceptable people, worthy of being regarded as people instead of targets. Love does not seek to create clones of itself. Selfishness does. View of one. Unchurched person. On being self-centered and judgmental, here's another one. Keep your religious beliefs to yourself. Again, disclaimer, this is unchurched people saying this about the church. Keep your religious beliefs to yourself. If I have any interest in what you believe, I'll ask you. And if I don't ask you, then go right ahead and assume that your, quote, witnessing will be unwelcome. I'm sure that you like whatever you believe very much, and I'm very happy that you like it. However, just as your favorite flavor of ice cream is not necessarily going to be mine, I wish you would assume that I'm just as content with my own beliefs, or lack thereof, as you are with yours. Why not ask me first? Now notice. Why not ask me first what I believe? Why not show an interest in what's interesting to me instead of expecting me to always be interested in what you're interested in? Christians are so selfish and self-centered. Tell me, when was the last time an atheist rang... Here, I got this from earlier. When was the last time an atheist rang your doorbell to tell you about his worldview? The reason the world hates Christians is because they behave badly, they're rude, boorish, arrogant, conceited, full of themselves, ignorant, and judgmental. Go ahead. Accuse me of being judgmental now. Whoops. Doesn't matter. I don't claim to follow a belief system that has actual rules against being judgmental, so it's fine for me to be. Now, did you hear the hint, though? We're living out there in the world, folks. God's called us to be world changers. And we have an oikos of people that are around us. And what did this person say? Ask me questions. Get to know me. Listen to me. And then what did the other person say? Don't just make me a target. And when I don't respond to your invitation, you ignore me, you leave me. Be willing to become a part of my life. That's your oikos, isn't it? Connect yourselves better to the people that are there. On being unwilling to develop true friendships with non-Christians, as a mother of young children in a homeschooling environment, this one will tick you off. We found ourselves surrounded by Christians. Of course, the kids would become friends, and we moms would chat while they played. Without a single exception, this acquaintanceship only progressed to the point that I had to make it clear that no, I would not accept Jesus as my personal Savior, and no, I would not be attending their church. Then the Christians never called again. And I was left to explain to my sad children why their new friends wouldn't be playing with them anymore. When my son was just 6, the boys down the street told him he was not allowed to play with them because he wasn't a Christian. I went down to see what was going on because my 4-year-old daughter was going to go down there and teach those boys a lesson. And I confirmed that what my son had reported was indeed what they'd said. And the mother of one was right out in the front yard, 25 feet from me, pretending to be very focused on trimming some plants. She never said a word. Finally, the 6-year-old girl across the street told my kids, ages 7 and 9, that if they weren't Christians, they would be going to hell. She certainly learned the, quote, good news. And you Christians wonder why we non-Christians avoid you? Hint, it's not because we're intimidated by your awesomeness and are just sitting here pining for you, wishing you would like us. We already know you don't. Oh, ouch. The world already knows we don't like them. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Love your enemy. Bless those who despitefully use you. Bless them and do not curse them. Love. Rob Toll, a pastor from Wheaton, Illinois, came up with 4 things that he said are essential for what really works today. And he said, number 1, you've got to rekindle your flame. Christ followers need to renew their commitment to Jesus Christ. We need to have a new conviction that God really is good news. Jesus is good news. And then build relationships with people around us just because God loves us and loves them too. Number 2, we need to be praying more. We need to spend more time praying and seeking God for opportunities to show his love to the people around us, just to care about them. God's got to be a part of it. God's the Lord of the harvest. 3, we need to go to the broken places. I love the work of New Life Center in Thailand, and there's a group now in Los Angeles as well. And what do? Guys, you and I can't do this. The ladies go to the brothels. You saw actually a picture, you maybe didn't realize it. You saw a picture of one on the video there. And it was a young lady who was in Thailand. And in Bangkok, there are some huge red light district. And young women are sold again and again into sexual slavery. And their bodies are sold on a daily basis. And the ladies from the New Life Center, some of whom used to work in those brothels, go into the brothels and they simply love on the girls. They just start loving on them. They'll go and they'll take them gifts. They go and they just greet them. And they show them God's love. And eventually, these girls are coming to them and saying, "Can you help me get out?" And you know that some of these ladies are actually buying, that's called redemption, buying these girls out of their slavery. And Jesus is setting them free. We need to go to the broken places where people are suffering right here in our community. And we need to teach people here in the church to be present. You see, the fact is, what this lady said in Rob's church in Big Bear is just really not true. "Well, there's no non-Christians around me. I don't know any non-Christians." Well, get out of your bedroom then. I mean, get out to where the world is, because there are unchurched people all around us, aren't there? There are people who totally don't believe in Jesus at all. There are people who maybe have some interest, but they're not there yet. There are unchurched people who used to go to church, but they kind of say, "No, there's kind of really a lot of hypocrites there, so I don't want anything to do with it," and all kinds of other things that they may say. And then there's those who actually are churched people, but just need your encouragement too, because aren't we supposed to be encouraging the body of Christ wherever we're at, building up one another? This morning, what I guess I want you to do is I want you to try to think oikocentrically. How about that one? Who wants to try to spell that one? I want you to think oikocentrically. O-I-K-O-C-E-N. Is it up there? Nope. There it is. I want you to think oikocentrically. You are connected to people every single day, and some of them are non-believers. But the problem is we're sometimes not intentional in the relationship building with them. I want you to start thinking more about connecting and caring about and getting to know the people that are around you. You need to ask yourself this question: why are you here? And I'm not talking about why you're sitting here at Crestline First Baptist this morning. Why are you here on this globe? Why are you here in this world? Why did God give you life? You see, what I really appreciate that Tom says, Tom Mercer, is this: we've all been placed here to reach our 8 to 15. To make a difference in their life, to change their world right around us. We've been called to be influential in our relational worlds, our oikos of 8 to 15 people whom God has supernaturally and strategically placed us among. Answer me this. How many of you made a commitment to Jesus Christ cold turkey because somebody knocked on your door or something like that? You never saw them before, and they came and said, "You need to accept Jesus." And you said, "Yes, I do." Please raise your hand. Cold turkey? No, I'm gonna test you on that one. Cold turkey, because I remember a friend that you had that told you about the Billy Graham Crusade, right? Think about it. Cold turkey. Never anybody. Here's the thing. Why are we here? I heard this story about a guy who was walking through an intersection in a large city. And he noticed a police officer directing traffic in the middle of the street. Light was out or something like that. As he walked by, the man sensed the Holy Spirit tell him to go to the officer and tell him that God loved him. The man dismissed the impulse and kept walking. As he walked away, he's haunted by the fact that, I think really God told me I was supposed to tell that man that God loves him. Finally, he turns around, goes back, and says, "Excuse me, officer, but God just told me to tell you that he loves you." Tears started flowing down the cheek of the police officer. He calls for backup. He goes to the corner with the man, and he right there, he says, I have been praying that God would send me somebody to prove to me that he exists. Send me somebody just to say that God loves me, to let me know that he is real. Thank you so much." Well, after that, all the people that heard that sermon and that story went out looking for all the cops in their community. But here's the problem. Very few of us are called to stop in the middle of the road and talk to the cop. Now, it could be that cops are in your oikos. Maybe you've gotten pulled over enough up here that the CHP knows you well, and they're part of your oikos. You know, maybe they've been to your house enough times that they know you. And so it could be that a cop is. But the thing is that we need to think oikos-centrically. Oikos-centrically, thank you. We need to be thinking about the people that are around us and start caring about them, whoever it is that God's connecting us to. Now, let me ask you this. How many of you came to know Christ because somebody built a relationship with you and maybe invited you to go to church or go to a small group or sit down and just talked with you about Jesus? How many of you came to know Christ that way? Please raise your hands. Okay, how'd the rest of you come to know Christ? Or you don't? What? That's somebody who shared Christ with you. You need to put your hands back up. How many of you, somebody shared Christ with you, built a relationship with you? That could have been mom or dad. It could have been a neighbor. It could have been a Sunday school teacher. Somebody invited you to get to know Jesus. Raise your hands. Why do you guys get so fast putting the hands down? How many of you, raise them again, because of somebody else? So you didn't? I didn't tell you to put your hands down yet. Look around the room. So only Russ is saying no. See, think about this. Yeah, it's because of relationships. You can put your hands down, thank you. It's because of relationships. Somebody built a relationship with you. Now, it might have been at birth, you know, as a mom or dad or something like that. May have been a neighbor, could have been a soldier. But somebody built a relationship with you. Folks, God's called us to build relationships. But here's the thing. Don't stop the relationship if they don't come with you to church. Continue building the relationship. The goal isn't, I'm sorry, I'm a pastor, I'd love to have the church growing. But the goal isn't for the church to grow. The goal is for the church to go. To go out into that world and to live for Jesus so that people can see Jesus in us and get to know him. And through that relationship, have that personal relationship with him. Why are you here? I guess I need to, as I'm getting close to wrapping up, I need to ask you, what do you really value? How many of you have been, where we got sent off the mountain? Evacuated. I lost the word. Yeah, thank you. How many of you have been evacuated off the mountain? Okay. How many of you believed the fire was really coming? How many of you took something important with you? You see, if you really believed the fire was coming, you took something of value. How did you decide what you took with you? Thank you. How did you discern what you're going to take with you? The other night, the wind was blowing really bad and we were getting ready to go down the mountain. I'm like, and I think I had started the heater downstairs, a room heater. Shh. So I'd had a room heater in room downstairs. And I'm like, well, should I leave that heater on or not? And I'm like, and then I got thinking, okay, so we have a pilot light. We don't have a real fireplace. We've got the fake one that's supposed to look real, but it's behind glass and all. But there's a pilot light in there on that fire. By the way, I turned the heater off downstairs. But I'm thinking about that pilot light, and I'm like, okay, that's a really pretty big flame there. And then I'm going to this other thought. What happens, because the trees are blowing down, and we've already had electricity go out and stuff like this. I'm like, what happens if that oak tree that's leaning over our house falls on the house? And when it falls, it breaks right through and it causes a fire because of that big pilot light that's burning in the fireplace. Because I was also going around, since the power had gone off, we had already had one of these outages previously, I was also unplugging everything to make sure that if the power surged back on, that it didn't get fried like it did the previous time. Right? So then I'm thinking, I got to protect this place. And then I'm like, oh no, do I need to take some things of value with me? I've got my German-Swiss Bible that's downstairs that came from the 1700s that has several of my family tree's names in it. Maybe I should go grab that Bible and take that with me. Well, what should I take with me? I mean, if you're warning me that this tree's about to fall and the house is going to explode, I mean, I don't want to just be dumb and leave everything here, right? Oh, yeah, Debbie has that shelf of all those scrapbooks. All the books of pictures of everything. Maybe that, I'm going to be really loading this car up just to go down this hill. What do you value? I mean, what really matters to you? If you were going to evacuate, if you're leaving, what is it that's really important to you? See, if we're paralleling this, the real question is not to ask the person, why aren't you going to church, or why don't you get involved in a small group? The real question is, what will you do instead? What's more important? What has more value than living for Jesus right where you're at? David took the 613 requirements of the law and he summarized them down into 11. Psalm 15. A psalm of David. Lord, who may dwell in your sanctuary? Who may live on your holy hill? He whose walk is blameless, who does what is righteous, who speaks the truth from his heart, has no slander on his tongue, does his neighbor no wrong, casts no slur on his fellow man, who despises a vile man, but honors those who fear the Lord, who keeps his oath when it hurts, who lends money without usury, and does not accept a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things will not be shaken. Isaiah took the law and brought it down into 6. He who walks righteously, this is Isaiah 33:15-16. He who walks righteously and speaks what is right, who rejects gain from extortion and keeps his hand from accepting bribes, who stops his ears against plots of murder and shuts his eyes against contemplating evil. This is the man who will dwell on the heights, whose refuge will be the mountain fortress. His bread will be supplied and water will not fail him. Well, let's make it easier. Micah put it into 3 things we have to do. Micah 6:8. He has showed you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. But Jesus put it into 2. Matthew 22. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" And Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest in the commandment. And second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these 2 commandments." That's the way it's supposed to work according to Jesus. The things that have the greatest value to Jesus are what? Relationships. Our relationship with one another. 1 John put it this way, whoever loves God must also love his brother. So what I want to challenge you to do is to make a list. In your worship bulletin, would you please take out that, I believe it's a yellow card this morning. Make a list of the 8 to 15 people that are a part of your life. Who are they? People that you have some kind of regular contact with over a week or 2 week period of time. Who are those people? Put their names on that list. And when you do that, then ask yourself, now how many of these know Jesus and how many don't? Please pray about this. Don't just listen to Pastor Bill saying this sermon and then go out of here with a blank card. Take that card and really take some time to give it some thought. And list the name of the... You're not going to turn this in. This is you and God, okay? Will you commit to loving your oikos? Will you commit to loving the people that God's put in your life on some kind of regular basis? A world changer is someone who actively encourages people in their relational world, their oikos, to become Christ followers or to grow as Christ followers. It may include non-believers, because some of the people that you're going to list there are non-believers. They have no relationship with Jesus Christ at all. And your role for them is to help point them towards Jesus. For some of your list is going to include believers who are not walking with the Lord. Somebody who's just said, you know, well, yeah, I knew Jesus, I believe in him, but I'm not living, but yeah, church and God and people, I can do it out there on the golf course. Which, by the way, is not true. And what's your role for them? Pick them up. Love them back to a closer relationship with Jesus. Be their cheerleader. And some of the people that you're going to write down on your list are believers who are actually walking with Jesus. And what's your job for them? If they're already involved in ministry, then your job for them is to encourage them to keep moving forward, keep growing closer and closer to Jesus Christ. Be their supporter. God's called us to be world changers of our world, our 8 to 15 people that he's put us in contact with. And by the way, what should you do then once you have your list? Once you make your list, you need to start praying for them. Yeah, daily would be really good. You need to get to know them. Ask them questions about them. Learn more about their life. You need to invite them into your home. Yeah, now I know that's tough for some of you. Hey, doesn't matter what size your home is, invite them in. In other words, invite them into the personal part of your life. You need to take time to get to know them, their concerns, their interests, their pain, their joys. And then introduce those unchurched ones to other Christian friends. Help them to have relationships with other people who know Jesus like you do. And then maybe you're ready to invite them to come to worship with you or to go to a life group or to go see a Christian movie. But it's not until you've spent a lot of time building that relationship and earned the right to respond to the question that James said, be prepared to give a reason for the hope that is in you. Father God, help us today to commit ourselves to really making a difference in these 8 to 15, to be world changers for the people that you've put in our world. Don't let us just go away from here and forget this conversation, God. You've called us to spur one another on toward love and good works. You've said that really, that we're supposed to go out there and be the church. Help us to do that now. In Jesus' name, amen.